Contents. Chapter 1, Introduction. 2, Defining Solitude and Solitariness. 3, Primitive Solitariness in Theology. 3.1, Christian Interpretations. 3.2, Hebrew Interpretations. 3.3, Islamic Interpretations. Chapter 4, Mythology and Solitude. Chapter 5, Romantic Solitude. 5.1, Romanticism and Solitude. 5.2, Romantic Poetry and Solitude. 6, Narratives of Solitude. 6.1, Medieval Narratives. 6.2, Enlightened Solitude. 6.3, Modern Narratives and Solitude. 6.4, Postmodern Narratives and Solitude. Chapter 7, Conclusion, and 8, Bibliography. Chapter 1, Introduction. And one again I am, I will not say alone. But how shall I say? Restore to myself? No, I never left myself. Free? Yes. I don't know what that means, but it's the word I mean to use. Free to do what? Samuel Beckett, Malloy. I am still surrounded by voices from the past that establish the foundation of our present and let us resume heading towards the future. Voices like Seneca, Avenpace, Montaigne, Rousseau, Thoreau, and many more, still leading and guiding us in this desert, this vacuum, this emptiness, arming us with a shell free from kingdoms and empires, free from dust capital and the organized cities, equipping us with an armor against states, public opinions, schools and institutions. We are all that solitary being who is doing nothing, helpless with no beginning or end, walking in a vast desert on a hot, scorching day, with illusionary dunes and moving chimeras. I am shutting doors on myself, withdrawing into my true identity, standing apart from encounter, choosing to die standing and closing all windows of technological developments that stole every authentic being in this universe. I am in a state of rest where I'm calling all my forces home, that state of the necessary becoming strong solitary in order to gather more strength to withhold. I am in that vast realm where you become fed up with being with false others, for we are all born alone and will carry on to stay so despite our will to be social beings. Living this melange of escaping from to this very ambivalence that sets our existence is so tiring, yet inviting me to write more. In this atrocious context, an awful truth, I find myself holding up my pen and resuming what I had already started, the necessary journey of writing about human solitude. It is necessary to trace back the sacred journey of solitude and write about the holy history of solitariness, letting the flood of questions and facts poison our brains to discover ourselves. Am I the only self on earth living such a state? Why this universal cry of solitude is still nourishing human company? Why this enigmatic solitariness is following us everywhere? And why do we desperately try to escape from this condition? Where does the pain come from? What makes us resort to solitude all the time we face trouble and mess? Why do we enjoy solitude when feelings of betrayal invade us in this global world, this crazy age of consumerism, this sophisticated world inundated daily by a wild waterfall of information? We are all deceived by this absorption, this addiction and unreasonable involvement in this digital world, a world that created a huge void only solitude can solve it. I am trying to gather all of my power and courage to write about the history of solitude from Adam up to now, for from our past we can learn and collect various meanings of our existence. From our ancestors we can trace back parts of our true being. What I'm writing is not an archaeological thought or the usual narration of events. Besides, it is not nostalgia of historical records, nor is it a story of a lonely, desperate self or an autobiography of a desolate, lost soul. But it is rather an attempt to go back safe to our authentic state, that simple but strong state with no homes or shelters, no skyscrapers, no highways, no traffic lights or any noise. Going back safe to the life of plenty, the life at the top of which the struggle to live with all its challenges, the strife to really exist and carry on existing. In this vertigo of consciousness, I am trying to regain the strong primitive moment when cavemen left us without a clear notion of time, because at moments of solitude, like in moments of love, no need to understand the succession of days or nights, nor is the cycle of seasons worth to be conceived. In this mess, I'm trying to rob the light and explain the timeline of human solitude, standing there alone before me. Before you, before us, is a holy state of return to nature, back to early life, struggling the same harsh conditions, crushing the heart of darkness inside the chest with stronger pains. The glare of the visuals may blind the insight from the secrets of life, the universe and nature, but the sane person may be aware of his treasure as well as the poet succumbs to inspiring feelings and the writer to weave imagination into the midst of the universe of chaos and the life of crowds where you may not find a person who trusts his or herself with all confidence or support. That's why you rush to nature and solitude, because it is the only fully-fledged passage that floods wisdom and sermons. I'm used to such trips, but this journey is peculiar, with particular marks and profound impacts. While I was walking between the trees of knowledge and those of eternity, I ended up near a great mountain that would break without any shame the strong red rays of the strong sun. And this is the most beautiful thing I saw, steadfastness and courage in this great land. It was crouching in the soft earth, extending itself strong, respectful, and majestic. Before everyone else, its height made the trees fear its hugeness. Its branches bowed, its leaves revived, and sent him from time to time gentle, soft breezes of love. Rather, I saw such scene as a treasure of tenderness and in the history of all mankind. I stood, not only hoping and admiring its appearance, but also to draw several instances of beauty through which I generated great respect and appreciation. The mountain hinted for a while that the birds from the top touched its top at times and stood at other times on its summits, as if happy with their freedom, the joy of submitting to greatness but quickly returning to the spacious sky mixed with anxiety. The hot ginger and red colours of the horizon woke me, so I suddenly realised that the sun was gone. At those moments, you can't feel the speed of time. You can only feel the gentle tickle if you are barefoot. The sands of the beach were yellow. Then I approached it and I stepped closer to the water. I increased thoughts and thought in my head and asked, I did not choose my name. Neither do I choose my end to prove, even once, the importance of my existence in this universe. But I chose my end between the folds of water, near the sea. And when I touched the tip of my finger with wet sand, I stood looking at this scene before I forget it forever. I glimpsed waves of water. It was a quiet still lurking in the valley of this sea. There is no movement and no life, as if ignoring my question and evading my conversation, as well as the hordes of shells. I added to this attractive view a certain expression, and the most beautiful thing is the red sun implanted on the horizon. There was an old boat at the edge, with shattered movement travels cold breezes as if it were inviting me to live again. Everything was beautiful. So I was a fool until I deprived myself of this enchanting magic. The mountain with its strength and the sea with its softness, like life with its cruelty and softness, and the sea in its calmness may turn in a fierce, treacherous second. But its proximity to the mountain gives it the greatest motivation to stick with life. I walked away with all that I saw and was pleased with what I had learned with great pleasure. No one is a master of his or her destiny. We must not envy a person for his or her money or knowledge, but rather envy him for the delicate feelings of solitude he or she always carries. Suddenly, I remembered that I had lost my memory, so I looked for it and did not forget the attractive natural scene, a scene that I will never forget. There is a pleasure in the pathless woods. There is a rapture on the lonely shore. There is society where none intrudes. By the deep sea and music in its roar, I love not man the less but nature more. From these are interviews in which I steal, from all I may be or have been before, to mingle with the universe and feel what I ne'er express yet cannot all conceal. What I lived and will undergo is part of everyone. First, our life with nature. Second, our life with men. The third, I and thou. So let's land in this island of solitude, discovering the voices of many lost souls, tracing back the sacred history of many cries of weak throats that we can mention only but few representative selves from here and there. My project is to keep faith in our solitary subjectivity, for the man who feels himself solitary is the most readily disposed and the most readily fitted for the self-reflection of which I am speaking. That is, the man who by nature or destiny or both is alone with himself and his problematic, and who succeeds in this blank solitude in meeting himself, in discovering man in his own self and the human problematic in his own. Therefore, achieve the human being in us. In order to enter into a personal relationship with the absolute, it is first necessary to be a person again, to rescue one's real personal self from the fiery jaws of collectivism which devours all selfhood. The desire to do this is latent in the pain the individual suffers through his distorted relation to his own self. Again and again he dulls the pain with a subtle poison and thus suppresses the desire as well. To keep the pain awake, to awaken the desire, that is the first task of everyone who regrets the obscuring of eternity. It is also the first task of the genuine educator in our time. Solitude offers us what other spaces of thinking, other modality, where we can meet different ingredients of perfection. I'm letting my pen engrave what the fuel of the history of solitude may inspire, echoing as many lonesome voices from the past with a never-ending thirst to offer the best in us. Solitude was there for us all the time in the human history, but we tend to ignore it. Solus was there for us with a special complex effect inside everyone, with a confusion reflected in our language and reality, a conscious fact that we undergo even when we are not alone, evolving many ambiguities, pain and serenity, escape and encounter, anxiety and meditation, refuge and curse, and many more complex states. Being solitary, nonetheless, can be that neutral situation where we can celebrate a positive reliance to find ourselves lonely, but with an objective subjectivity. Solitariness is far from isolation, but closer to being the key of all that is inside, the freedom and warmth of the self. In discussing solitude, we are not only unveiling its truth, but we are also discovering how it works, how we can benefit from it, and therefore how we transform it to be our bliss, joy, and purification. Let us compare between the life of the socially active person and that of the solitary. For as for many wise thinkers may claim that we are not born for ourselves, but for the community, the thesis that lasted until now, man is a social being by nature. We can notice that those who are in public affairs are living in a corrupt world full of errors, the world to make their private advantage at the public expense. The corrupt ways by which in this, our time, they arrive at the height to which their ambitions aspire, manifestly enough declares that their ends cannot be very good. Whereas living in solitude, lack of company, lack of disquieting emotions, and the absence of physical discomfort are the conditions of perfect reflection, another modality of thinking with lesser errors, because provided that I am still trying to determine the world's existence on the foundation of my soul being, I make myself the center of the globe and the referee of the world. My mindset is that if there is to be anything at all, it will have to be my own conditions and laws, satisfying and meeting my individual requirements of proof standards that are set down by my confidence that I myself exist alone. All my knowledge becomes depending on my personal comprehension of my own individual existence. The only way for me to know anything else is for me depends on tracing it back to my personal knowledge of myself in solitude. Solitude is a state of self-defense, resistance, and never-ending longing for justice and an instance of freedom as well. The others can no longer harm because the solitary is beyond their reach. What more have I to fear from them since all is ended? Not being able to make my situation worse, they can no longer fill me with alarms. The uneasiness and dread of the evils from which they have forever delivered me is some comfort. The infection is very dangerous and risky in the crowd. Social life is full of rejections, isolation, and conspiracies. So everyone must either imitate the vicious or hate them, and both actions are not safe to take. Either to resemble them because they are many, or to hate the many because they do not resemble us. Living with the mobs is full of noise, corruption, and hypocrisy. Life in such a way is full of falsehood. Whereas living in solitude may bring back reveries and innocence, the divine favor that you might get safe to shore. Why do we seek climates warmed by another sun? Who is the man that by fleeing from his country can also flee from himself? Tracing the holy history of solitariness is therefore a necessary mission forgotten by many. It is an obligation, because although it is an instance of pain, it may also be an opportunity for wisdom and freedom. In solitude, the wretched person feels his whole wretchedness and the great mind the full extent of its greatness. In short, everyone becomes aware of himself as what he is. I will conduct a reading of human history to check the development of the concept and how human beings lived that condition in various phases of history. I'm trying to answer the question of whether to see solitude as an absolute painful destiny for the human being, or just a secondary state that unfolds human existence, for we seem to forget about our own solitude, though it is the most central to our human nature. Chapter 2, Defining Solitude and Loneliness. The capacity to be alone was adumbrated as a valuable resource, which facilitated learning, thinking, innovation, coming to terms with change, and the maintenance of contact with the inner world of the imagination. Anthony Storr, Solitude, A Return to the Self. All the way along my previous works, either literary books, mainly novels, my collection of poems and my theatrical play, or some theoretical essays, and of course through the next coming papers of this work and possibly in future books, I am trying to define concepts of solitude and solitariness. All I found myself doing is to come closer to the sphere of the network of meanings as well as thoughts and feelings that such concepts offer in order to explain how they function and the possible ingredients that interact while deciphering them. My attempt is to define something that everyone can live and is aware of, but not as giving meaning. It is rather a never-ending process to be experienced. The consciousness of solitude and the project of solitariness is not that clear possible idea. It is rather that positive process of involvement in the choice of being alone. The real experience of being solitary is something different, however. Being solitary is something much deeper in human nature. We can discover our solitude even when we feel lonely inside the others, and all of a sudden we recognize we are not like them. Such recognition is an experience of an innate human condition that can be celebrated through a deep, penetrating journey of an everlasting process of self-discovery. Such process is a treasure, a fortune, and a gift that awakens us from time to time in order to perceive the light at moments of darkness, to find fragments of beauty here and there whilst turning inward, and to hear the human voice inside us realizing the brevity of our life and how every moment counts. There is a power in loneliness, a purity, self-immersion, and depth which is unlike any other experience. Being lonely is such a total, direct, vivid existence, so deeply felt, so startlingly different, that there is no room for any other perception, feeling, or awareness. Loneliness is an organic experience which points to nothing else. It is for no purpose and results in nothing but the realization of itself. Loneliness is not homelessness. There is no departure or exile. The person is fully as he ever can be. Solitude, loneliness, the solitariness have many different faces, and there are regions of overlap between them, having a lot of common characteristics. For me, both concepts mean the same effects, though in sociology, as well as in psychology, they consider more the term loneliness to be with negative meanings and solitude as a word with some positive meanings. In psychology, loneliness is generally considered as a negative emotional state which most people seek to avoid, whereas sociology sees it as an indication of deficiencies in the number or extent of one's social relationships. Given the fact that sociology is the science that studies the external general causes and effects that originate either in the social or physical environment, we can understand how it has its peculiar reading to the phenomena, leaning more on the collective side at the expense of the individual. Peplau and Perlman, for example, define loneliness as the unpleasant experience that occurs when a person's network of social relationships is significantly deficient in either quantity or quality. This definition shares three points of agreement with the way most other scholars view loneliness. First, loneliness results from a deficiency in a person's social relationships. Loneliness occurs when there is a mismatch between a person's actual social relations.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.